How's everyone feeling? How you living? Good? There's a conversation between a man and God in Scripture that I believe is helpful. It's fitting for us to observe in this time that we're in. Have you ever walked into a conversation and immediately you knew you were an intruder? Like you knew you shouldn't be there? Like, that's how intense this conversation was. This man is sitting on the side of a hill, and he's overlooking a city, and he is ticked off. He's angry. He's upset. Dare I say suicidal because of what just happened. The setting is mid-8th century B.C. At this time, Assyria was the dominant world power. They were perhaps the most violent and cruel empire of ancient times, a terrorist state. They were murderously violent and brutal towards their enemies. Israel had a front row seat to their atrocities because of proximity. The distance from Israel to Assyria is about the distance from here to Salt Lake City, Utah. And so Assyria exacted heavy tribute from Israel throughout this man's lifetime. And so Israel was not only witnesses of the things that Assyria had done, but they were victims of it as well. And it was this nation, Assyria, that was the focus point, the focal point, the object of God's missionary outreach. God came to this man, Jonah, and he told him to go to the capital city of this wicked nation, Nineveh, and preach against it. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the people of God. I thank you for my family, for those who are here, and those who are online. I thank you, God, for all that you're doing in our lives. Lord, there is no debate about who the leader of the free world is. And so we just thank you that you are present right now to heal and to set free those who are here. I have the poet Eminem in my head who says, nowadays everybody want to talk like they got something to say. And Lord, they have not come to receive a slim perspective or a shady heart posture. Oh, I'm going on this. But Lord, we want you. We need you, Lord. We love you. It is impossible to receive any eternal results without heaven's help. So I will not beat on the door of hearts that can only be unlocked from the inside. Only your spirit can do that. I can't. And so I'll wait for you. Jesus' name. Amen. That was not planned. That was not planned. So we're first introduced to Jonah in 2 Kings chapter 14 in this obscure one-liner in verse 25 that you'd almost miss if you weren't looking for it. But it tells us a lot about this prophet. Unlike his contemporaries, Amos and Hosea, who at the time were criticizing Israel's king and royal administration, Jonah supported Jeroboam's aggressive military policy to extend the nation's power and influence. And so Jonah would have been known not only as a prophet and a man of God, but he also would have been known, and I know this is a cuss word today, so just hang with me, but he also would have been known as a textbook nationalist. Textbook. I mean, he was highly partisan. He was intensely patriotic. Yet it was him, not Amos, not Hosea, it was Jonah who God sent to preach to Nineveh. And we're in a series that we've been calling Jesus 2020. And we're doing a flyover of the Sermon on the Mount. And there's just as we talked about it, friend, there's no way to do this text justice. When we were in Bible college, we took a class, The Life and Times of Jesus. And one of the things you had to do to pass this class, you had to memorize the Sermon on the Mount. I didn't get far. But it's such a sweet, sweet book. So we could probably study this book for the next 2 years. This book is in the heart of Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, and it's become known as the ethics of the kingdom. It has been said to be the fundamental recipe for the conduct of the followers of Jesus. It is a message that Tolstoy and Gandhi both were intrigued by. Augustine referred to it as a perfect standard of the Christian life. Brandon quoted a source last week that called it a new political possibility. It is, to borrow a phrase, Jesus' inaugural speech to those he has elected to be citizens of his kingdom. And in this message, Jesus puts to rest this nominal, religious, this externally present but externally hollow approach to relationship with God that is not transformational to us and certainly not life-giving to the world. And so looking at the structure of this address real quick, Jesus starts with the Beatitudes, which are the characteristics of his kingdom citizens, and then he moves to their influence, which is salt and light, which we're going to touch on today. Then he moves on to the fulfillment of the law and prophets, which are practical ways to live out the law of God from the heart. He talks about anger, he talks about adultery, he talks about divorce, he talks about money, among other things. And then he concludes with a caution. And at the end of chapter 7, Jesus references a narrow road that leads to life versus a broad road that leads to destruction. A tree that produces good fruit versus a tree that produces bad fruit. And a house wisely built on rock versus a house foolishly built on sand. Two paths, two trees, two houses. Externally, everything looks the same, yet one path destroys its travelers, one tree poisons its consumers, and one house collapses on its residents. And the point that Jesus is trying to make here is that it is very possible to say that you are a kingdom citizen, that you can self-identify as a follower of Christ. Everything externally can look like the real deal, but really you're on a destructive path. Your diet is killing you, and your fall is coming. So then what does it look like then? What does it look like to be a kingdom citizen that has the law of God written on our hearts in such a way that is transformative internally and life-giving externally? How can we be sure that we are people who walk this narrow path, produce good fruit, and wisely build on a firm foundation? Let's look together. We're going to look at Jonah's journey to the hillside because I believe in his journey, we get a picture of the type of people that Jesus is calling us to be in the Sermon on the Mount by looking at who Jonah was not. And what we're going to see is a refusal to be salt and light and a posture of superiority that is at the root of both refusals. All right, you guys ready to go with me? First, let's look at Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. All right, so Matthew chapter 5, verse 13 says, "You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt has become tasteless, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by people. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all those who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men, they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." Amen. The word of the Lord comes to Jonah, and God tells him to get up and to go east to Nineveh to preach to the city. But Jonah's first inclination, his knee-jerk response, is to get up and to run west. Right? He goes in the exact opposite direction God tells him to go. Now think about this. He is a prophet. Right? His job, by definition, is to represent God to man and to speak to man on behalf of God. Yet, when he's told to do so, he runs. So he runs west, and he goes down to the port of Joppa, and then he jumps on a ship that's headed farther west to Tarshish. Jonah shows himself in this moment to be the antithesis of the kingdom citizen Jesus spoke of in the Sermon on the Mount by his refusal to be salt and light. See, the way you can tell the difference between a heart change internally by the gospel and external religious righteousness is in its relationship with the world. Christianity is attracted to and attractive to people in positions that don't agree with it. Just look at Jesus in the gospel accounts. All right? He got a reputation of being a friend of sinners. Just look at his very disciples. Right? He got crewed up with, you know, a thief. Right? He got crewed up with a tax collector. Right? With a fisherman, with a zealot who is basically a political revolutionary, among many other things. All right? And so Christianity is attracted to and attractive to people in positions that disagree with it, while religion is turned off by and alienating to people in positions that disagree with it. Salt and light are positive, life-giving resources. And so here's the question for you. The question is, are you salt to this world, or are you salty to this world? Right, the new modern, for those of you who, why was that funny? The new modern definition of salty means to be petty and bitter, right? Right. Are you salt or are you salty? You don't know? Go ahead and ask. Just leave here today and go ask your coworkers. They'll tell you. Leave here and go ask your unbelieving friends. Go ask those who follow you in your Facebook timeline. And I have an idea. Go ask someone who belongs to the opposite political party as you. We should move on. Let's talk about salt. So what is salt? All right. Salt was a precious commodity in ancient civilizations. It created and destroyed empires. In America in particular, it was a major factor in the outcome of wars. In Jesus' day, it was both the driver of technological development and a stable source of revenue for thriving economies. I think I heard it somewhere that there's over 14,000 positive uses for salt. All right? And so most practically, salt enhances the flavor of food and it prevents rot. All right, there was no refrigeration back then, but by spreading salt all over certain foods, it served as a preservative to prevent the advance of corruption and decay. Salt symbolizes purity. It symbolizes durability. It halts the spread of infection, and it promotes healing. It even has an irritating quality. Right? Like it dissolves slugs. How many of you guys have a slug or two? You have a slug or two you need to dissolve, right? Let's talk about light for a second. What's light? Light is the very source of life. Like, just think about the sun for a moment. It's the best example. Nothing is more important on this earth apart from the Son of God than the sun. Without the sun's heat and light, the earth would be lifeless. It would be a ball of ice-coated rock. The sun warms the seas. It stirs our atmosphere. It generates our weather patterns. It gives energy to the growing green plants that provide the food and oxygen for life on earth. In a spiritual sense, light is that which pierces darkness and gives illumination to those who need it. It exposes the things that are intended to be hidden. Scripture says that men love the darkness rather than the light because their deeds are evil. Jesus said, if anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble because he sees the light of the world. Darkness and night are scripturally synonymous with confusion and lostness and despair. I believe it was the rapper Houdini who said, the freaks come out at night. Yeah. I'm trying to wake you guys up. So the people of God, kingdom citizens, are a precious commodity on this earth. We are called to be the difference between a nation that thrives or perishes. That we've been commissioned to influence outcomes when it comes to war and peace. We represent life. We represent truth. We represent purity. We represent durability, healing. We are meant to be spread throughout the world to prevent the advancement of moral corruption and to exterminate spiritual darkness. And not only do we light up the world and bring out the flavor, we don't just make our homes and our neighborhoods and our cities and our workplace and our Zoom calls good, but we bring out the taste. We give the world the potential to be the best versions of itself. That's who we are. But by running away from God and from Nineveh, Jonah was refusing to be salt and light. And salt loses its flavor when it becomes mixed up with impurities that contaminate it. And when light is put under a basket, at best, it dims the whole room. At worst, it'll set the room on fire. And Jonah finds himself in the middle of the sea, in a storm, with unbelieving sailors, on a ship that's about to shipwreck. And it's an accurate picture, guys. It's an accurate picture of what a morally corrupt church looks like in the world. Jonah was counting on Nineveh's moral corruption and decay. And when God asked him to go shine light, when God asked him to go sprinkle some salt, when God asked him to go love and serve and preach to the people of Nineveh, he knew that it meant the possibility of preservation. So he said, I'm out, and he ran. And this is sort of a pun, but think about Jonah if you know the story. This man finds himself in a storm. He finds himself on a ship that's about to shipwreck. He gets himself thrown off the ship. He finds himself in the belly of a fish. And Jonah is so not salty. He has so little flavor. He is so bland to the taste that even a fish of the sea opts to spit him out on shore. That's messed up. Not even good enough to get eaten. And so he finds himself on shore. In Jonah chapter 2, he apparently has this conversion experience in the belly of the fish. And upon getting puked up on shore, he agrees to go to Nineveh, right? And with no preparation, no passion, no compassion, low effort, Nineveh is a three-day walk. He walks one day, and he preaches the lamest sermon you have ever heard in your life. He walks around the city, and he says, in about 40 days, that's it, guys. You're done. What are you doing? And then he dips. He just leaves. But the result is every preacher's dream. Every preacher's dream. He goes into the city, doesn't even try, leaves, and the whole city repents. The whole city repents. They humble themselves, they proclaim a fast, they issue a decree, and God does not destroy them. And so now Jonah is sitting on the side of a hill, overlooking the city, and he is ticked off. He's angry. He's upset. Dare I say, suicidal. And he says this to God in that moment. He says, see, God, this is why I ran. This is why I ran, because I knew that you were gracious and compassionate. I knew you would have mercy. And I love how this reads in the message. The message says it this way. He says, I knew you were rich in love. I knew that at the drop of the hat, you would turn plans of punishment into a program of forgiveness. If you won't kill them, kill me. Jonah's fears, Jonah's prejudices, Jonah's emotional breakdown all stem from his blindness to the reality of grace. And if we believe we have earned grace, we will require others to pay at least the same price we paid. If we believe we've earned grace, we will require others to pay at least the same price we paid. If we believe that we are recipients of grace because of who we are, then someone who is unlike us will never be welcomed in. Maybe Jonah thought that he earned his birth into Israel. Maybe he thought he earned the office of prophet. How about you? Did you earn your income? Did you earn the neighborhood you live in? Did you earn your influence? Did you earn your health? Did you earn being an American? Did you earn the day and the time in world history that you were born in? Okay. What I love about the Bible is that it's not just primarily a series of stories with a moral, though there are very practical lessons in it. but it is a record of God's intervening grace in the lives of people who don't seek it, don't deserve it, continually resist it, and don't appreciate it after they've been saved by it. We don't know anyone like that, but it's cool to see it in the Bible. God engages Jonah in the midst of his pity party. I'm so glad to see that. Aren't you? Aren't you glad to see that? He's in this petty tirade. He's in this petty tirade. He's upset, and God engages him. God entertains these remarks with a conversation, and it reveals his tenderness. It reveals his compassion, his relentless grace towards Jonah. The same grace, by the way, that he was showing Nineveh. You know, the way I look at this is, you know, God's mission field is always just as much our hearts as it is the people we think we're helping him reach. And God says to him, is it right for you to be angry? See, Jonah's angry relapse has to do with an inordinate concern for his nation's political fortunes. As long as serving God fit into his plans for Israel, he was fine with God. But as soon as he had to choose between the true God and the God he actually worshiped, everything changes. He turns on the true God in anger. And so Jonah's love for his people and his patriotism, which were good things, became an ultimate thing. It became an idol. C.S. Lewis, in his book, The Four Loves, he says an inordinate love for country becomes a demon when it becomes a god. We see this further into the argument when God appoints a plant to grow up over Jonah to shade him from discomfort. Jonah was extremely happy about the plant, but then God appointed a worm to attack the plant and it withered. And all over again, Jonah becomes angry and despondent, and God launches into this legendary rebuke. This is what God, in so many words, this is what God says to Jonah. He says, Jonah, you have compassion for plants, but not for people. I sent you to preach to the city, and you did it, but it was all external. Your heart wasn't in it. Yeah, you preached to the city, but you didn't love the city. And now you come out here, and you post up, hoping to witness their condemnation. Jonah, you will never get it until you stop weeping for plants and start weeping for people. God was telling Jonah, I'm not just the God of Israel. I'm the God of the universe. And I think we need to hear that as well. God is not the God of America. He is the God of the universe. Like Jonah, if we forget that God is sovereign over all nations, we make God small, we remake him into our image. He starts to talk like us, he starts to look like us, he starts to hate the people we hate. Compassion for plants over people looks like valuing things that are of benefit to me over someone else's distress. Weeping for plants over people looks like, and are you guys ready for this? This one's gonna hurt. It looks like a refusal to pray for the President of the United States when he comes down with COVID because it doesn't fit our patriotic bend. Oh, I'm not done. It looks like the inability to mourn the death of a Supreme Court justice because it would somehow feel like conceding to a political enemy. What is wrong with us? You can never effectively preach to a people you don't love. This is why Jesus referred to himself as the greater Jonah. Because while Jonah went outside of the city hoping to witness his condemnation, Jesus would one day go outside the city and go to a cross to accomplish his salvation. People over plants. It's not about renouncing politics or becoming apolitical, right? We're not called to be apolitical. American churches in the 19th century, early 19th century, the ones that didn't speak out against slavery were actually casting a vote for the status quo. So not being political is actually being political. We're not saying that. What we're saying is that to be political or compassion for people requires political engagement. Just take Jesus with you. And I've decided that, and as Amy and I talk about it, and we talk about it with our family and our friends, you know, we've decided, you know, that we just don't really care that much about being right all the time. And if being right and getting our way is going to force me to dim my light, if it's going to force me to not be salty, and the good salty, okay, if it's going to cause me to do that, I'm out. I don't need it. I have a political preference, like you have a political preference, yeah. But this is what we decided, and I know some people don't understand this, and I get it. But here's where we are. We would rather see our political candidate lose than lose our witness. We should move on. I love the way the book of Jonah ends, and we're almost there. Because right as the argument is getting good, it's over. Jonah doesn't even respond. Like, mic drop moment from God. Jonah says nothing back. And so, you know, right as the argument is getting good and you're all licking your chops, and man, what are you going to say? It's just over. Like, you turn the page, you're like, what happened? It's over. Why does it end so abruptly? Sinclair Ferguson, he's a Scottish theologian. He suggests that the book is forcing us to contemplate our own personal destiny. It remains unfinished in order that we may provide our own conclusion. For you are Jonah. I am Jonah. Tim Keller, in his book, The Prodigal Prophet, he says, it is as if God shoots this arrow at Jonah, but Jonah disappears and we realize the arrow is aimed at us. So the question is, will you be salt and light? Will you preach to people out of love for people? Will you stop weeping for plants and start weeping for people? Listen, we're all politically charged up right now, right? We saw record participation in the voting polls, right? We saw so many of us engage. And what that means is that we all recognize the significance of the moment. We do. But if you've become distasteful during this political season, if you've allowed your light to dim, if you've had a posture of superiority, it may be because you've become more political, more patriot than Christian. You've been more committed to a plant than to people, a kingdom planted in this earth rather than a kingdom in heaven. And if you're here today, and you're confused, or you're angry at God, that's quite natural. But if you remain in that situation, if you remain there like Jonah, it will be because you do not recognize, you do not embrace the gospel of salvation through faith in Jesus Christ alone, a gospel in which Jonah himself was a sign. Jesus Christ is the weeping God of Jonah chapter 4 in human form. He is the ultimate representation of salt. He poured his life out for us to save us from moral corruption. He is the light, and in him there is no darkness at all. The Bible calls him the Son of Righteousness. In him is life. And that life is the light of man. And politics is nothing new to Jesus, by the way. You know, the Jews, they wanted political reform from their Messiah. Right? They envisioned a Messiah who would rule and deliver them from Roman oppression. Right? They wanted a Messiah who would sit on a Jewish throne. But Jesus came to die on a Roman cross. And though the cross was the devil's ultimate smear campaign, Jesus said, I will prove my kingship to you, not by winning the popular vote, not by being elected, but by being executed. Jesus walked the broad road Jesus ate the bad fruit. Jesus allowed his frame to collapse and fall for you. And when you receive him, when you become one of his kingdom citizens, he will change you from the inside and make you life-giving on the outside. Amen. Let's all stand with him. Lord, that feel like their life is about to wreck. Or maybe like Jonah, they feel like they are in the belly of a fish. Or maybe they're just on the side of a hill and they are ticked off. But I thank you, God, that you meet us in every place we may be. Lord, we echo the prayer of Jonah in this time that salvation is from the Lord. And so if you're here today, and you say, Sean, I know I need Jesus. I know I need to get right with Jesus. Or I've been right with Jesus, but I know I need to come back. Just slip your hand up. We just want to pray for you as we end. Amen. I see you, sister. I see you. Two hands, three hands. Another one's gone up. Four. Amen. Anyone else? Five. Six. Listen, though your sins initiated a death sentence, though they set in motion plans of punishment, Jesus executed a program of forgiveness by going to the cross. And on the cross, Jesus said to his Father, kill me, don't kill them. Raise your hand. I just want to pray for you. Listen, Jesus loves you. Jesus cares for you. Jesus died for you. That's really what would make your separation from God such a tragedy. Christ has already been paid. And the only thing that'll stop you is the pride that says I can do it on my own. This is my last call. We got to go. Stick your hands up. Raise your hand. Lord, I thank you for those who raise their hands. I thank you for those who are making a decision right here, right now to come to you, Jesus. And I ask that you will give them what they ask for. Lord, you said in your word that those who hunger and thirst for righteousness shall be filled. And so, Holy Spirit, we just thank you for the heart that you, the work that you can do inside of hearts. And I ask that you would complete that work. Begin to do that now. In Jesus' name. And everyone said,